Good morning and welcome to Service of Christ Baptist Church service on this July the 19th, 2020. I'm going to have the service start by reading from the second Peter chapter 9, verses 12 through 22. But these, as natural viewed beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they understand, not and shall utterly perish in their own corruption, and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness, as they that count this pleasure to rot in the daytime. Spots they are, and blemishes sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you, having eyes full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sin, regarding unstable souls, and heart that have exercised with covetous practices cursed children, which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness, but was rebuked for his iniquity, the dumb ass speaking with man's voice, forbid the madness of the prophet. These are wells without water, clouds that are carried with a tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. For when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they are lured through the lust of the flesh, through much wantonness. Those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruptions. For whom a man is overcome of the same, is he brought in bondage. For after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome the latter, and is worse with them than the beginnings. For it has been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered until them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mirror. That is the end of the scripture reading, and now you will hear from Reverend Jones for our sermon. Have a good day. Bless you all. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. We praise the Lord and we give God all the honor and all the praise for the great things that he has done. We would appreciate it if you would move the Facebook camera to us, please. Thank you. We praise God for all the things that he's done and what he is going to do inside of our lives. And we give God all of the honor and all of the glory for how wonderful, truly wonderful, that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ really is. My brothers and sisters, you have heard the reading of the scripture this morning, and I just want to focus in on a few verses this morning as we prepare to deliver the message of God found in the book of 2 Peter at the 21st and the 22nd verse. The Bible reads as follows, "For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, than having known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them, according to the true proverb, a dog returned to his own vomit, and a sow, having washed to her wallowing in the mire." That's a very compelling and very interesting scripture that the Lord Jesus Christ has given us today. Today, I would like to focus on doctrine. I would like to focus on false doctrine. But before I do, let me have a brief word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your love and your peace. We indeed thank you for your patience. And even now, as we come before your presence with exceeding joy, we give you all the honor and all of the glory for all the things that you have done. Dear God, we praise your holy and your righteous name. For truly you have blessed us in so many different ways, even coming through this pandemic of the coronavirus, how you have protected us and kept us thus far. But even now, God, as we come before your presence with exceeding joy, we do give you the honor and the praise. We thank you for our first responders.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for our doctors, our nurses, our police officers, all those who are serving the public and putting themselves at risk. We pray for them today in the name of Jesus. And then, God, we pray for the pastors and the ministers who are going forth and ministering to people, those who have been involved in homegoing services where many of our citizens have transitioned from labor to reward. We pray that the ministers will be protected. We pray, God, for the churches in opening back up. And thank you, God, for allowing some of these churches to open and still others remain closed. But we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come to the sanctuary to worship you in spirit and in truth. Yes, God, we do give you all the honor because, Lord Jesus, you are the one that died, shed your blood that we could have this right to eternal life. And for that, we are forever and humble grateful to you for the service that you provided by shedding your blood. For those of us that believe in you, dear God, we know, hallelujah, amen, that we in fact will see you on the other side of this life.
Yes, Lord.
Because we believe that you are the Son of God,
yes,
that you did die, that you did shed your blood, that we could have that right to see you,
yes,
where there will be no more suffering, no more pain, no more sorrow, no more disease, no more politics, just pure joy and everlasting life with you. Bless this word that we're about to bring forth on false doctrine, anointed, consecrated for your use and for your glory. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. We thank you, Lord, for those who have come to the service today. Trustee Patricia Strickland, First Lady Patricia Jones, Minister Patricia Jones, and all the others that will be arriving. We thank you, Lord, for the offerings that have been sent in through Facebook, through our website. We thank all those who are not members of our church but have chosen to go to the church, Service for Christ, Inc.org, our website, and have given us donations to help the church to survive during this pandemic because we haven't got any help from anyone else.
Thank you, Lord.
And we thank you, God, for being faithful.
You
told us that if we are faithful over a few things, that you will make us ruler over many. We have no desire to rule anything,
amen,
but we do have a desire to serve you, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, and if I left out anything, please forgive my heart and my mind, because I want to make sure, God, that you get all the praise and all the glory,
yes,
and not Jerry Jones or anyone else.
Amen.
You told us in Ephesians 2, 4 through 8, not of works, lest any man should boast. Amen, Lord Jesus, thank you.
Amen.
Thank you so much, amen. Amen. My brothers and sisters, I'm excited today to be here with you for this service today. I'm excited about the word of God and what God is going to do in our lives. Yesterday, we had the privilege, the opportunity, I should say, to provide service for a lady by the name of LaJuan, her son Nathaniel Pace, and her entire family experienced a traumatic death of Nathaniel Pace, a victim of black-on-black crime, which black-on-black crime is running about 93% in the United States right now. Latino Hispanic crime is running around 94% Latino on Latino murders. And in our white community, it is running 92%. Now, many people would have us to believe that a black on black crime is the only crime that is being committed and that black lives don't matter to black people. Well, if we use that same analogy that black on black crimes don't matter to black people, and the black crime rate is 93%, then what that says is, if we use that analogy, then 94% of the Latino community don't care about crime on Latinos. Or conversely, that whites don't care about white life either. So if we're going to use a standard, then we should use that standard across the board. And if we're going to say that blacks don't care about blacks, then we should say that whites don't care about whites 92% of the time, and Latinos don't care about Latinos 94% of the time. Be that aside, what the Bible teaches us, in fact, is thou shalt not kill. We are concerned about all crime, and we are concerned about all murder rates, and we are believing that we ought to follow the ordinance, the statute, and the commands that God has put forth to us, that thou shalt not kill. That is a truth. Last week we talked about what is truth. What is truth? We talked about it yesterday. And when Jesus was asked by Pontius Pilate, what is truth? In fact, Jesus said that everyone that hearing my voice will know the truth, or knows the truth, that he is the truth. He is indeed, according to John, the way, the truth, and the life. And there is no other way except for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You see, my brothers and sisters, what we are confronted with and faced with as a people is a very serious set of challenges, obstacles, and indeed opportunities in our lives. A lot of people think that because we have initiated this Black Lives Matter movement because of the deaths of many black people at the hands of police officers that have the badge of honor that they turn into a badge of terror, many people believe that the Black Lives Movement is against white people. It's not. Black Lives Matter is simply saying that where police officers and others are killing black people, that those people committing these atrocities and these crimes, they think that black lives don't matter. Because if they thought that black lives matter, then they would not kill black people. You see, my brothers and sisters, we have to get our thinking straight. Okay. We got to get our thoughts straight. Well, for many of us, we do believe that black lives matter.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that white lives don't matter. Look at your statistics and you tell me what you think about white lives. It doesn't mean that Asian lives don't matter. It doesn't mean that our Jewish friends' lives don't matter. And so you come up with the proposition that all lives matter, but we cannot exist without each other.
Amen.
It's really something to think about.
It is.
You see, my brothers and sisters, today's sermon is on false doctrine. And what we've been fed by much of the media and the indoctrination training that we've learned from children, you see, our worldview, that matters. What we think, what we believe, and how we process information intelligently. When I thought about Nathaniel Pace being murdered because he was trying to stop a fight between two females, the only thing I can say is that that's stupid. That someone trying to create peace would be murdered because they're trying to help. It's not anything that is different from what happened with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who came that we could have peace and so that we could have life and have it more abundantly. And what did they do to Jesus Christ? They strung him up on a cross, put nails in his hand, crown thorn on his head, whipped him all night, would beat him, ripped his flesh wide open, and he was only coming to serve as a sacrifice for you and I, that we could have the right to eternal life. But many of us refuse to accept our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's sacrificial death, so that we could have eternal life as a friend coming to save us. Such as what we have with this recent death of an electrical engineer, Nathaniel Pace, came to help and end up dying because he was trying to help. You see, my brothers and sisters, what I've come to realize in the time that I have and the little time that I have left on this earth is that we have to get our doctrine straight. And you might ask yourself, what is doctrine? Well, doctrine is a set of beliefs, a set of principles, a set of rules on how we are going to act and how we are going to behave. It's what we learn in theology. It's what we learn in science. It's what we learn in math. It's what we learn in literature. Doctrine is no more than what we know and what we learn. And when you stop to think about it, y'all ought to be shouting right now saying, amen, I see you out there.
Amen.
And I'm not talking about the people in the sanctuary, I'm talking about you at home. You ought to be getting up out of your bed, getting your tea, and sitting down and listening to what thus say the Lord.
Amen.
Because a doctrine will drive you mad. Mm-hmm. And what is even worse is indoctrination. It's when you are indoctrinated to racism by bigotry, prejudice, sin. All these things indoctrinate us to respond and behave in the way that we are taught by others. But it is not, in fact, the true word of God. Let's dive into the word of God, and we give God all the praise and the honor.
Amen.
This second epistle of Peter, the author is Peter. It was written around AD 65 to 66. That's almost 36 years after the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We have several doctrines that we deal with, my brothers and sisters. On July the 1st of this year, 2020, the United States of America celebrated 244 years of independence, as they wrote the Declaration of Independence,
yeah,
on July the 4th, 1776. And you see, my brothers and sisters, what that teaches us is this. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bonds which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth, the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitled them, a decent respect to the opinion of mankind, recognize that they should declare the course which impel them to the separation. The Declaration of Independence goes on to say that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal,
yeah,
that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Amen.
I cannot think of one person in this United States of America that is a citizen that does not hold these truths to be evident in their lives. Yeah. However, down through the 401 years that blacks have been held in slavery, in bondage in this country, including the current year, through economic oppression, discrimination, racism, and other political means, Martin Luther King simply said that he went to cash the check, and the check was returned for insufficient funds. This doctrine, to a lot of people, has not been a doctrine that many people can uphold and adhere to And thus we have these conflicts of interest. We have the conflicts of interest in what we're taught, what we recognize, what we see, and then in fact what we actually believe based on how we are treated as people.
Amen.
Some of you say, well, you know, you're very radical in your thinking. No, we're not radical in our thinking. What we're doing is that we're waking up. And so we are imploring every single citizen of this country that it works for all or it works for none. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, when we talk about false doctrine and false prophecies today, we want you to open up your mind for yourself and think, does this apply to me? Does this apply to my family? Is God telling me something different than what I've been taught or what I know? You see, my brothers and sisters, false doctrine according to 2 Peter chapter 2, in the very first verse, it talks about false prophets are among the people. Amen. It talks about what happens to false prophets. False prophets will receive swift destruction. Amen. If you look at verse number 1, there's swift destruction to false prophets, those who don't recognize and state the word of God in its true form. Amen. And many will follow this shameful ways of these false prophets, bringing the way of truth into dispute.
Yeah.
You see, in the Christian world, my brothers and sisters, what we have is that people are bringing the word of God into dispute and making the word of God null and void because of false doctrine. Mm-hmm. And here's some examples for you. The angels in the book of Jude 6 were cast out of heaven because they did not maintain their first estate. False doctrine. Hallelujah. God did not spare the ancient world of Sodom and Gomorrah because they did not uphold the principles, the ordinances, and the statutes and the commands of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. False doctrine, my brothers and sisters. God condemned Sodom and Gomorrah to swift destruction. And the same thing will happen inside of your lives as well. When you do not follow the ordinances, the statutes, and the commands of God, swift destruction upon your life. You may lose your home, you may lose your wife, you may lose your car, you may lose every single thing because of false doctrine. I'm asking you, come here, pay attention. I want you to listen to what thus says the Lord on this good day. God also knows how to remove my brothers and sisters and punishment from those who practice or those who hold false doctrine. In other words, those who teach false doctrine. I'm talking about pastors who might teach false doctrine. Many teach false doctrine because they are not learned, because they don't know the way of truth. And how do I know? Because you can sit back and witness and watch the way of truth in their behavior, in their conduct. Teachers sometimes don't know the way of truth. Men and women that are consecrated for God's purpose do not understand that swift destruction will come upon you, in fact, if you are, in fact, practicing a lie and living false doctrine, my brothers and sisters. Christ says these things to us, hallelujah, my brothers and sisters, but in vain do you worship me, teaching false doctrine, the commandments. You don't teach the doctrine of the commandments, my brothers and sisters. In Mark chapter 7, verse 6 through 7, say, how be it in vain do they worship me? You worship me in vain, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. And hallelujah. And also then verse 8 goes on to say, for laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the tradition of men as the washing of pots and cups and many other such like things you do. God is saying that you do everything else. Hallelujah. You do everything else. You follow what man says for you to follow. But when it comes to following the ordinances, the statutes, amen, somebody, and the commands of God, you do what man says rather than what the word of God teaches you to do.
Amen.
What that says is that we have to check ourselves.
Amen.
And he says unto them, full well you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition. Let me say it again, because somebody was sitting on the couch and didn't hear it. The Bible says, full well you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition.
Yes, amen. Preach.
You want to hold on to homosexuality, your tradition? It's not of God.
Amen.
Go read Leviticus 18:22. A man shall not lie with a man as a woman.
Amen.
You want to rob? Go ahead. God says you shall not covet in the book of Exodus chapter 20. You want to steal? You want to have idolatry? Read Exodus chapter 20. You want to disrespect your mother, your father? Read Exodus 20. You want to commit murder? Read Exodus 20.
Yeah.
False doctrine. God is saying that you would rather reject the imperative, the commandment of God, and in fact, keep your own tradition. I say to you this, keep your tradition.
Mm-hmm.
But as it says in the very first verse of 2 Peter, it tells you very clearly, swift judgment will come upon you. Our text today cries out for you to consider three things: false prophets, false teachers, and indeed privately begin to do the business and the work of God.
Yeah.
Many people deny the Lord, according to verse number one, who brought them out of darkness, and like Peter, he denied Jesus three times, even when he already knew that Jesus was Lord. He already knew that he was the Son of God.
Yeah.
He already recognized that God had allowed him to walk on the water. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Not only that, my brothers and sisters, sometimes we practice pernicious ways in our lives. That's highly injurious or destructive ways in our lives.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but if someone told me that if I went down the street to a store and I was going to get $500 million, I went down there to that store and it was not there, I would be totally disappointed.
Amen.
If someone told me that the way to eternal life was through door number five and I walked through that door number five and I was straight in hell, I would be highly disappointed.
Amen.
If someone told me that if I went down to the car dealer and that they were giving away cars, and I got down there and all the cars had been sold and none had been given away, I would be totally disappointed.
Amen.
If someone told me to go down to the department store, amen, somebody, and I went down to the department store, and when I got there were no jobs, but they told me that the jobs would be there. In other words, my brothers and sisters, when you are told a lie and when you are told something that you are counting on, amen, somebody, when you're told that this will happen and such, and you go and you put your time, your effort, and your energy, almost like when I realized that when I went to school and got these degrees, these six academic degrees, that I would get a certain job, and when I went to get that job and someone else had the job, or they said that because of my skin color, that my skin color would not let me get the job. They didn't say anything about my education, how that was going to help me get that job. That indeed was false doctrine. Some of you haven't experienced that. Some of you have been given things that you didn't deserve. Some of you have been given things that you did not earn. Amen, somebody. Some of you did not even go forth to work on anything that would bring you glory.
Amen.
Or bring you the income that you so richly deserve.
Yeah.
Yes, my brothers and sisters, not only do we have this situation where we have pernicious ways in our lives, but we also have covetousness, and we also have presumptions, and we also also have a natural ability to do the things that are in total opposition to God. Amen, somebody. And not only that, we will receive the reward of our unrighteousness. You might not want to accept that, but you will receive the rewards of unrighteousness. And our egos have pushed us into adultery. Idolatry, amen, somebody. And we cannot cease from sin. Every day when we wake up, the first thing that we think about, many of us wake up and we think about, what can I do to satisfy my flesh today? Amen, somebody. We wake up and we wonder, how can I go get over on somebody? Amen, somebody. We wake up and we try to figure out what's next in my life, but we don't focus in on the word of God that is going to bring us to the truth. We don't focus in on the word of God that's going to bring us to victory. We don't focus on the word of God that's going to bring us a prosperity. Amen, somebody. We don't focus on God to know that he is the truth, the way, the life, and that he is the ultimate being. He is the creator of the stars, the universe. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Yes. Yeah. My brothers and sisters, not only that, another form of doctrine is shown in our behavior and what others see us doing. We tell the wrong things by lying, cheating, stealing, fornicating, lusting, and all the things that I have mentioned. We fail to study the word of God. We fail to honor God in multiple ways, including false worship. We don't worship God in the way that God should be worshiped. Amen, somebody. And not only that, we don't tithe to the church. And we don't, and you know, it really, for those of you who get offended by the pastors, I'm trying to figure out why you get so offended. Excuse me. Why do you get so offended when the pastor is trying to help you and talk about your tithing?
Amen.
Or your lack of tithing?
Yeah.
You get all scrunched up. Like, why you talk? All you want is money. We don't want your money. What we want you to do is we want you to prosper.
Amen.
God said, you have robbed me. Not you have robbed Jerry Jones. You have robbed God. Can you get that in your head? Can you get that in your head? You're robbing God, not Jerry Jones.
Amen.
If you belong to this church, then you need to be tied into this church.
Amen.
If you belong to another church, you need to tie to that church.
Yeah.
But failure to bring your offering to God is false doctrine. God gives you everything. The cattle on a thousand hills belong to God.
Yeah.
The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, not a part of it.
Okay.
And what God has given to you, he's saying, return it back. Don't get upset because you are being called out for not doing what God has commanded you to do.
Yeah.
False doctrine.
Amen. In
other words, my brothers and sisters, our behavior is false doctrine through engaging in immoral acts, through speaking foul words out of your mouth or language out of our mouths by not giving God the reverence due to him. He died on the cross for us.
Yeah.
He shed his blood for us.
Yeah.
He gave us eternal life, and we decide that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he died for our sins, for our trespasses, and that he deserves our love for what he has done to help us. And all we have to do is say, I receive the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as my personal Savior.
Amen.
But we'd rather hold on to our own ego. Where's your ego going to take you? I'll tell you the truth right now. Your ego is going to take you straight to hell. And hell is going to be cast into the lake of fire. You decide. Not only that, my brothers and sisters, this false doctrine, whether you are in the pulpit or whether you are on the usher board or if you are the deacon or you're the trustee, if you're a pew warmer, if you're sitting at home and refuse to go to church with bedside Baptists and sister sheets, amen, somebody, or you perform whatever function that you're performing, whether you do what is required of God, guess what? God's still going to get the glory out of it anyway.
Amen.
Do what you do. God's going to get the glory.
Come on now.
Well, you know, I was thinking about, hallelujah, help me, Lord Jesus. I feel my help coming on right now. I was thinking about the book of Esther and Mordecai and Haman. And Mordecai told Esther, when she was afraid to go forth and do what thus say the Lord, to save the Jewish people, because Haman was trying to annihilate all of them. And Mordecai said, if you don't do what is required, guess what? Salvation will come through another source.
Yeah, that's right.
What we need to know as Christians is that whether you adhere to the ordinances and the statutes and the commands of our God, salvation will come through another source.
Yes, it will.
When I was at Peace Baptist Church, people just stand up in the pulpit and say, I don't want no rocks crying out for me. I was a young lad then. I didn't really understand what they meant by the rocks crying out. You see, God's going to get the praise out of every single piece of his creation.
That's right. Yes, he will.
And whether you want to stand forth and create and praise the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that's going to be your choice. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
But God knows full well that he is worthy of all the praise and all the honor. That's why he tells us automatically to honor the Lord thy God in all that we do and say.
Yes.
You see, my brothers and sisters, today I'm concerned about our youth.
Yes.
I'm concerned about the young people who don't have a way out and who depend on ungodly parents and unrighteous parents to lead them and guide them. And I'm concerned about our widows. Amen. I'm concerned about the elderly. I'm concerned about those people who cannot take care of themselves and those children who are being led around. But I also admire and support and love those parents who do take care of their children. I also love and admire those parents who do fulfill their responsibility as man and woman and respect their marriages. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I'm talking about false doctrine today. Lord Jesus, when you get down to verse number 20 through 22, you can just stop reading, or you can continue to read in the book of 2 Peter chapter 2. When you get down into the end of the scriptures down there, what we see, let's see what we have there, my brother and sister. What we have is these words. For if you have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you are again entangled. I think Jada Pickett said recently, amen, that she was entangled. She used the word entangled in them and overcome. The latter end is worse for them than the beginning. Jada Pinkett, whatever it is, Will Smith's wife, go back and read 2 Peter chapter 2, verse number 20, and bring that to the red table. Amen, somebody. The Bible goes on to say in verse number 21, for it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn from that holy commandment delivered to them. And I'm not going to pick on anybody, but I will say this. Once you accept and receive those marriage vows and you say for better or worse, or for richer or poorer, it doesn't say anything about getting entangled. It doesn't say anything about taking a break. But what it does say is that you are to honor your vows, whether you are separated or not. When you are divorced, there is now what the Bible calls a writing of divorce, and you are legally separated. Until that time, you are what? Married.
Yes.
Don't try to bring us. Do not try to bring us no false doctrine.
Yes. Amen.
About entanglement.
Yes.
That's false. Mm-hmm. On every level.
Amen.
I am not the judge. I'm reading what the Bible says. Don't try to take me away from what the Bible teaches us. That is the problem right now. Is what I've been preaching about today, is that we go back to the ways of man rather than sticking to the word of God.
Amen.
But it happened to them, according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit.
Yes.
Return to your vomit and lay in high mirror of disruption and destruction. Because one thing that we know, amen, somebody, is that false doctrine destroys.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
We as preachers, we stand around, we sit around, and we do nothing. And we get up in the pulpit and we want to hoo ha, ha amen. We do all that. But what about the word of God getting out to people where they can receive the word of God in their heart, in their mind? I don't care about hooping and hollering. But what I do care about is that the word of God go forth with boldness, with courage and power, and speak the truth about God's word. Doesn't matter to me whether I have a full church or an empty church. What matters to me is that we're doing the will of God.
Yes.
What matters to me is that I'm standing as an ambassador for my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Don't bring me the false doctrine. Don't bring me twisted scripture. Bring me the word of God in boldness and truth and power and encouragement. That's what we need. That's what God's people need. And my brothers and sisters, I believe that this is the reason why God has reorganized the church. Many people are going to church and they're being traumatized.
Yes.
Listen to our Bible studies on Wednesday night on Facebook and hear what the people of God are saying about how they're being traumatized and they're being emotionalized rather than being spiritualized.
Yes.
The Bible teaches us that those who worship God must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Yes.
I'm going to leave you with a few things, then I'm going to take my seat. I know people out there right now are getting excited and some are upset. But I'll tell you this. In getting to the truth, you may have some struggles in your life.
Yeah.
In getting to the truth of God's word, you may end up being like my brother Paul. I'm going to look for the scripture and you all can just turn to it with me in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, my brothers and sisters. Excuse me. 2 Corinthians. Paul teaches us a very important lesson. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 15 in your Bible. And someone else go to the book of Galatians. You see, my brothers and sisters, there's some rewards and there's some penalties for us not following the ordinances, the statutes, and the commands of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Before I get to Corinthians, I do want to digress for 1 second and go back into the book of Galatians. And I'm going to give that to you right now. In the book of Galatians, the Bible teaches us a very fundamental lesson here. I'll go give you the chapter in a second. I'm going to give you in the book of Galatians chapter 1. In the book of Galatians chapter 1, the Bible records these words, and then I'm done after Revelation. The Bible teaches us this. Chapter 1, verses 6 through 9, Galatians. Paul goes on to say to the Galatians, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that call you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you. Excuse me. There be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed.
Yeah.
You can read that in your spare time.
All
right. In other words, what Paul is saying is that I'm shocked, I'm surprised. Indeed, I am alarmed. I'm alarmed. That even after having known the truth about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, even have to know the truth, it would have been better for you not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered to you. It would have been better for you not to even have known the word of God rather than know it and turn away from it. And you accept false doctrine in your life? Not only that, my brothers and sisters, but as I said, I wanted to mention to you about the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, hallelujah, chapter 15. I believe I'm there. And what that teaches us is what the gospel is. It tells us these words. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherewith we stand, by which you also are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how the Christ died for our sins, according to the scripture. And he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scripture. That is the true gospel. Christ died. Indeed, he was buried. And indeed, he rose again from the grave. And some of you in implementing all of this, you might say, well, I'm going to get into some serious trouble once I start following the ordinances and the statutes and indeed the commands of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, you know, there's a penalty if you don't. But what the Bible teaches us in the book of Revelation, chapter 22, verses 18 and 19, is something very compelling to all of us in the book of Revelation, chapter 22, verses 18 and 19. And this is what God says to us about false doctrine. He goes on to say in verse number 18, for I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And in verse 19, God responds even further to false doctrine. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. I declare to you that you need to really understand the doctrine of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You need to understand that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all the things that you can ask or think, that God is able to deliver you out of your drug abuse, out of your alcoholism, out of your homosexuality, out of your lying, your cheating, your stealing, out of accepting the doctrine of men rather than accepting the doctrine of God Almighty. He is the great I am that I am. He is Alpha. He is Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the one that raised Lazarus from the dead and, hallelujah, raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. Amen, somebody. God's doctrine is going to surpass all understanding, all time, throughout all eternity. I declare to you one thing. Govern yourselves accordingly.
Yes.
May God bless you, my people. May God bless you. I want to say that if you'd like to get in contact with us, you can reach us on our website, Servants for Christ Incorporated. Servant for Christ Incorporated. ServantForChristIncorporated.org. And that is S-E-R-V-A-N-T-S, Servants for Christ, INC.org. We are a small church with a big heart. We give all we have until we can't give, as we are able to give. I want to thank all of you for watching, for tuning in on CTV television. I want to thank all of you, my Facebook friends, faithful and committed to watching us every Sunday morning at 8:30. May God bless you. We love you. We thank you. For all of our church members here in the sanctuary, God bless you for your faithfulness, For those of you that have left the church, God bless you. We love you, we thank you, we praise God Almighty for every single thing that He has done. Remember one thing, my brothers and sisters, if you don't have a church home, and if you have not accepted our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, today is a good day to get your doctrine straight and you can accept God. For He is worthy of all the praise and all the honor. He's standing there with His arms open, wide, waiting for you to come into the kingdom of God. Amen. That you might have the right to eternal life. I tell you the truth today, that is something to get excited about.
Amen.
For those of you that have missed the sermon this morning, I'm going to teach this again on Wednesday night on our Bible study. I will not be preaching it. I will be teaching it slowly so that those who missed the sermon today. And why would I do that? Because false doctrine is present, and false doctrine should be known. People can no longer say, I didn't know, I didn't understand, because God has sent forth a powerful word to your hearing today. All you have to do is bow your head, accept Jesus Christ. And if you want to join in with our church, contact us on Service for Christ Incorporated, INC.org, and tell us that we want to join the congregation virtually through Facebook or through our television broadcast. We're asking that you will go to our website and support our ministry in any way that you can. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, give you all the praise. Lord Jesus, thank you for this great opportunity to present your word with clarity, with power and boldness, according to your will and according to your riches. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Good day, everybody. May God bless you. This is Service for Christ Baptist Church in Fort Washington, Maryland.